He was right. This lesson is loaded. This parable, the son rejected out of Matthew, the 21st chapter, verses 33 through 46. So this account takes place in the courts of the temple in Jerusalem. And it's just 2 days before Jesus' triumphant entry into the city. Or 2 days after, I'm sorry, 2 days after his triumphant entry into the city. And so this parable is without a doubt, it's very pointed. Jesus is given here so far because it's his final warning to these religious rulers. In this parable, Jesus said, but last of all, he sent unto them his son. And the son was actually standing before them, giving them this parable. So it's very directive, it's very pointed. He's telling them right now what's in their hearts. But what are they going to do with God's son? Because man, even yet today, man imagines that they can be their own masters, that they can have a right to do with their lives what they please. Now, don't we hear that today more than ever? I have rights. We have, all we hear is equal rights. It's my right. I can do whatever I want. We see that so plainly today, and that's what Jesus is teaching them and trying to get them to see. Everyone today, it seems, does what seems right in their own eyes, and they always find an excuse for doing it. Being their own masters. That's what the lesson is about. Being our own masters, and thereby coming to our own ruin and our own death. And it's illustrated so plainly in this parable of the householder that we're going to study today. Now, this was Christ's last great day teaching in Jerusalem. If you remember, this is the time of the Passover. He's just entered this grand city. And if you remember, on Monday night after cleansing the temple, he returned to Bethany with his disciples because, remember, all that time in that during that week, he never stayed in Jerusalem overnight. He went back to Bethany, probably to Peter's house, to get, escape all the people that were in the city at that time, all the people around Jerusalem that had come for the feast. And so the next morning on his return to Jerusalem with his disciples, they noticed that the fig tree that he put a curse on the day before, Monday morning, for being unfruitful, they noticed that now it was withered, it was dead, it was dry at the roots. And from this incident, Jesus taught them the power of the prayer of faith. And when they arrived in Jerusalem and went into the temple, the chief priests met Jesus and they began to question him about his authority. And they said, who gave you the authority to teach the way you do? Who gave you the authority to do the things that you do, to say the things that you say? Who gives you this authority, they asked. And Jesus simply answered them by saying, but by asking a question. That's what he did. Then he asked a question. So, question about John the Baptist. He said to them, well now, what about the baptism of John? Which was it? Where did it come from? Did it come from heaven? Or did it come from men? He said, now if you can answer me, if you can tell me whether it came from heaven or men, then I'll tell you by what authority I do all these things that you're asking me of. Well, they had to think about this because they knew that if they said from heaven, then he would say, well, why didn't you believe him? Why didn't you believe? If he was from heaven, why didn't you believe him? But if they said, well, we think he was of men, well, then they knew the people would be against him. And they feared the people because all the common people believed that John the Baptist was a prophet sent by God. So they couldn't very well say because of men, because the people would rise up against him. So they answered Jesus and they said, we don't know. We can't tell you because we don't know. So Jesus said to them, and I bet he had kind of a smirk on his face. Well, neither tell I you by what authority I do all these things then. And he silenced them. And then he proceeded to teach them this, the parable of the two sons in verses 28 through 32. And he followed that immediately afterward by this parable of today's lesson, the parable of the householder, illustrating his own rejection and its consequences. That's what Brother Don brought to you out of the scriptures he read today. So let's pay special attention to the deliberate, to the decisive tone that Jesus uses in this parable. He's going to force his these religious rulers to act when and how he chooses, and not how they choose. As we've already seen, when they asked him who gave him the authority to speak, he put them to silence. So let's begin our lesson by reading verse 33 together. Hear another parable. There was a certain householder planted a vineyard, hedged it round about, and digged a wine press in it, built a tower, and led it out to husbandmen, and went to farm. Now this parable, which this judgment carried home to the religious leaders of Israel, is one so simple, it's so clear, that they can't fail to understand it. Chapter 5 of Isaiah compares the nation of Israel to a vineyard planted by God. It says the householder here represents God the Father who loved Israel. So the householder now represents God. He loves Israel with an everlasting love, and he did everything possible for them so that they might bring forth the best of fruit, like obedience, like sincere worship, like righteous living, like love, joy, peace, and all the fruit of the Spirit. He placed them in Canaan, the best country in the world of that day, and he defended them from their enemies, and he hedged them around with laws and other divine commands and rules to help them bring forth good fruit and to present it to the Lord. So the husbandmen represent the priests and the doctors of the law of Israel and the people as a whole. Just as God entrusts his work to be done by the church today, he entrusted it to these priests. They were the husbandmen. And he was going to go away, and he said, you take care of it till I return. So the householder in this parable then represents the priest. And then he planted a vineyard. Now that vineyard, as we just read, is Israel. He hedged it with a fence, which means divine protection around his vineyard. He put a wine press in it in the midst of this, and the wine press represents the law and the sacrificial rites that he gave Israel. And he put a tower in it, which represents the temple and the divine presence of God. And then he left it and went to another country. He left his vineyard. He left the care, he left the cultivation of it to his entrusted husbandmen until he returned, who were the priests and the doctors of the law. Therefore, this parable and what it represents is probably the most pointed, the most direct that Jesus has given so far to the priests and the elders, because it's his final warning to these religious rulers. And notice, when in this parable Jesus said, but last of all, he sent to them his son. He's speaking of the householder's son. Notice, the son he's speaking of is standing right before them giving them this parable. That's why it's so direct, so pointed. He's standing right there, speaking of himself to them. What are they now going to do with God's Son? Jesus is telling them right now what's in their hearts. So the householder left his vineyard in the care of the husbandman to cultivate it, and left the country, expecting them to take care of it so that in the fall, the fruit from his vineyard could be gathered up. There would be good fruit. So let's read verse 34 now. When the time of the fruit drew near, he sent his servants to the husbandmen that they might receive the fruits of it. So again and again, the householder sent servants to remind the husbandman that he was expecting fruit from his vineyard when he returned. You see, God gives freely, but he expects something always in return, doesn't he? So it was a reasonable expectation. He never threatened them. If they ran behind in their work, he just sent them his servants to help a little and to remind them of their duty and of the rent day and to help them in gathering the fruit on harvest day. Now these servants represented the master himself, the householder. They went. He told them, go back and see what's happening in my vineyard. And so they represented the master, the householder, and they spoke in his name. But were they respected by the men who were left to care for that vineyard? Let's read verses 35 through 39. And the husbandman took his servants and beat one, killed another, stole another. And again he sent other servants more than the first, and he did to them likewise. But last of all, he sent unto them his son, saying, they'll reverence my son. But when the husbandman saw the son, they said among themselves, oh, this is the heir. Come on, let's kill him, and let's seize on his inheritance. Now notice the treatment of the servants the master sent out. The husbandmen of the vineyard looked at those servants. They didn't like being there. So it says they took the servants, they attacked these messengers that the householder husbandmen had sent. And they beat one, they killed another one, they stoned another one. What had they done? They had betrayed the householder who had left his vineyard in their care. He had trusted them to cultivate his vineyard, to care for it till the day of harvest when they could all enjoy the fruit of it together. Well, so again, the householder sent more servants, and more in number than he had sent the first time. Send them at harvest time. He sent them to help these people that were tending his vineyard to gather in the fruit of the harvest. Now notice here the householder's loving kindness. It wasn't worn out by the husbandman's cruelty of those he sent to help them. It wasn't worn out, but rather, look what he did. With each act of their wickedness, he gave mercy. He sent fresh troops again and again. Gave them opportunities, gave them calls. He gave them chances to repent. He's so long-suffering. But every opportunity, every group that he sent to help was met with resistance, met with rejection. Every messenger that he sent was met with cruelty, with violence, selfishness, acting as if they were their own masters, doing whatever they felt was right in their own eyes, taking care for the vineyard as if it were their own, and as if they had a right to do that, as if they had a right to do whatever they pleased because they were taking care of the vineyard. Just like today, isn't it? Many, many leaders in our churches today, and I'm speaking of it, the church at large, I'm not speaking of any specific denomination, but just as our churches of today are showing a self-seeking spirit, and that's what's going on, a self-seeking spirit. Therefore, they're pushing God aside, they're watching, they're watering down God's word, and you know our stand on that. And just like Paul said, he said they're preaching another gospel, and then he said, which is no gospel at all. So, two times now we've seen that the householder has sent to these husbandmen, supposedly watching his vineyard. He sent his messengers to his vineyard at harvest time to help him to gather in the fruit. And every time he sent his servants to help them, they killed him, they stoned him, and they beat him to death. So finally he said, this owner of the vineyard said, what am I going to do next? What am I going to do? What shall I do? Every one of my messengers that I sent back to my vineyard to help the servants that I left in charge of every one of them, they have beaten them, they've killed them, they've stolen them. What am I going to do? And finally he thought, well, there's one more thing I can do. He says, I've got a son, and even though he's my one and only son, and I love him dearly, he's my beloved son, he said, I'm going to send him. I'm going to send him down there into that vineyard, because surely they'll reverence him. They know he's my son. Surely they'll respect him. He's my only son. And he's so much like me. Surely they'll reverence him if I send him in my place. So he sent his beloved son into the vineyard. And this was the last and the crowning effort of divine mercy. After all the other resources had been exhausted, this was the last thing. And he said, surely now, if I send my only beloved son, who's so much like me, they'll reverence him. He's my closest representative. I have a right, as the owner of the vineyard, to expect that they will treat him better than they treated my other servants before him. I'm sure that they'll reverence him. But did they reverence him? I'm afraid not. When the husbandman saw the son, they got together and began to whisper and they got their heads together and they said, look, this is his heir. This is the heir to this vineyard. He sent his heir down here. This is great. Because if we kill him, guess what? Then it'll go on to us, and we can claim this. It'll be all ours. We'll get the inheritance. Son's gone, we'll get it all. They had a great plan, didn't they? They recognized this new, important messenger right away, because he was so much like his father. What a wild, ignorant scheme these husbandmen had, to even consider that if they murdered the householder's son, the heir to the vineyard, they could then obtain ownership. And from this point on, this parable now becomes history. It just kind of changed scenes. It becomes history. It becomes prophecy. Because it represents the priests and the religious rulers of Israel who felt no security in their possession of authority while Jesus was present. So what did they do? They tried to kill him over and over as he was working in their midst. But they knew that if he was removed, then they would be saved, their position would be saved, and their claims would be undisputed, and they would be the heirs. That was their plan. So So these husbands wish to lord it over God's heritage, to retain their rights and their prerogatives over God's, to be their own masters and have their own prerogatives over God's, be their own masters. This was their conspiracy, but didn't turn out the way they expected it to turn out. They had their own way. When the son of the householder came into the vineyard, they caught him. They cast him out of the vineyard and they killed him. Now this is pointing to none other than the death of Christ. That's what was done. When he suffered outside of the city of Jerusalem. Where did he suffer? Outside of Jerusalem, in a place called Golgotha's Hill. Handed over to the heathen to be judged. Represented by the husbandman in this parable. So they had their own way. But their gain was their ruin. And they were punished. Now we're talking about Israel. This is the prophecy here. Were punished because of the rejection of the householder's son. So let's read the rest of our lesson in verses 40 through 46. And the Lord thereof of the vineyard and he said unto him, he will miserably destroy those wicked men, and he'll let out his vineyard unto other husbands, which shall render him the fruit in their seasons. And Jesus said unto them, did you never read in the scriptures? The stone which the builders rejected, the same is become the head of the corner. This is the Lord's doing, and it's marvelous in our eyes. Therefore I say unto you, the kingdom of God shall be taken from you, and given to a nation bringing forth the fruits thereof. And whosoever shall fall on this stone shall be broken, but on whosoever it shall fall, it will grind into powder. When the chief priests and the Pharisees had heard his parables, they perceived that he spoke of them. But when they saw his hands on him, they feared the multitude, because the day of the prophet. So as a husbandman, those left in charge of the vineyard persecuted the householder's son. They would treat the householder himself. And here is their doom, read right out of their own mouths. For Jesus now looked right at the priests. He looked at the elders and the people that were standing around them. And he asked them this very direct question. And he said, when the Lord of the vineyard comes, what will he do to those husbandmen? What, in your opinion, will be the course taken by the Lord when he revisits his vineyard, knowing full well all that has transpired in his absence? So do you see what Jesus is doing here by asking this question? It was designed by him that they might condemn themselves and admit the justice of the punishment that was soon to come upon them, to come upon Israel. By their answer, they would blindly condemn themselves. They think that they own the vineyard, but the property is his, and he's going to make them know that it's his. He's going to make them know. He's going to lord it over. They're trying to lord it over him as if it were all of their own. Though he delays his coming, he is going to come. And when he comes, what will he do to those cruel persecutors? And Jesus is coming again. What will he do? That's what he's trying to warn us of today. You know, all of this quoting, all of this political stuff, all of this voting, all of this anger and bitterness and resentment, it's all that he's trying to get us to see. He's soon coming back to his vineyard, the church, today. He's coming back soon. Well, the religious rulers are not quite sure where Jesus is going with this. And consequently, they continue to bite until they hang themselves. Isn't not what we do. Because they said to Jesus, well, the Lord will miserably destroy these wicked men. Aren't they foolish because they're talking about themselves? And he said, what do you think you're going to do to these wicked men? Oh, well, he's probably going to really destroy them, they said. And he'll let out his vineyard to other husbands who will render to him the fruit in due season. Well, they know what's right. What's wrong with them? Don't they know he's talking to them? They answered according as if they knew exactly what would happen, but they didn't think it was about them. He would take away their privileges and he'd give to others. The case was clear. They couldn't answer any other way. He wanted to show them the justice of taking away their privileges and the justice of the punishment that was going to come to them, and which was fulfilled about 40 years later when he did. He allowed Romans to come in to destroy the city of Jerusalem and the whole nation. Now Jesus had justly pointed, he plainly stated this to them in the beginning. And if, well, rather, I have to say, no, he didn't explain this in the beginning. He didn't do it in the beginning. He could have, but he knew that if he had done that then, they wouldn't have heard him because they weren't ready to hear. So he used this parable to try to explain what he wanted to tell him right out in the beginning and not waste all his time. So he did it in a parable to show them the very truth that he was trying to communicate with them. He thought they would understand it. And as we see, they had now nothing to answer. However, they still didn't really see the bearing of what he was really telling them. But still, they had no answer. So Jesus illustrated his parable further now, and he took them to the scripture. Always took them to the scripture. One that he knew that they had read, they had sung, but they hadn't really applied it to their own lives. It was Psalm 118, verses 22 and 23, which says, the stone which the builders rejected, the same has become the head of the corner. This is the Lord's doing, and it's marvelous in our eyes. The builders rejecting the stone is the same as the husbandman abusing the son of the householder that was sent to them in this parable. The chief priests and the elders of Israel were the builders. They had the oversight church, which was God's building, but they wouldn't allow Christ a place in their building. They wouldn't accept his doctrines. They wouldn't accept his laws, his teaching. So they just threw him aside like a despised, broken vessel, like a stone that would serve only as a stepping stone to walk over, a stone to be trampled upon. But Isaiah prophesied. As Isaiah prophesied, the stone which the builders rejected, this is Jesus, whom the Jews rejected, God would make what? He would make the chief cornerstone. For he who was the Gentiles, for he was rejected by the Jews, and he was let out and embraced by the Gentiles. What Jesus said to these religious rulers. And he said of them this, the kingdom of God shall be taken from you and shall be given to a nation that will bring forth fruit thereof. And so by this emphatic you, he's looking at it and saying, you are given to a nation. A nation that will bring forth fruit. He directly points to them and very plainly he implies that they are the very condemned husbandmen in the parable and that they will be held accountable they'll be subjected to terrible sentence that they themselves have pronounced and brought upon themselves. So here Jesus predicts again the rejecting of the Jews, predicts again the rejection of the Jews and the call of the Gentiles by the blindness of their mind and the hardness of their heart. They rejected the gospel of Jesus Christ. They rejected the kingdom. And the kingdom of God would be taken from them and given to a nation that would bring forth fruit thereof. And so now Jesus, he applies the scriptures, which he quoted in verse 42, which they were aware of, they knew. He applied that, and to their terror, he said, at this stone, which the builders refused, that's them, is set for the fall of many in Israel, and for all who reject him today and want to be their own masters, even yet today. That same thing applies to the church and those who reject him yet today. For, he went on to say, whosoever shall fall on this stone shall be broken, but whosoever this stone falls on, so to fall on that stone means to come to Jesus for your salvation in this day of grace. But to reject Christ is to have the stone fall upon you. Because later in the final judgment, at the second coming, when he comes again, when the householder comes back to the vineyard, comes again, second coming, that's what he's talking about. So this stone cast out of the mountain without hands is going to break in pieces all who oppose it or reject it, and it will grind them to powder because they don't have sin. This is the sin, this is the ruin of all unbelievers. Well, at last the elders and the chief priests and all the others who had been standing and listening to this parable perceived that Jesus was speaking directly to them and of them, and they were angry. They were angry. They'd gotten caught again. And they tried over and over and over to get him, to accuse him. And now they've failed again, and they were very angry. They knew that they spoke about their own doom. They'd gotten taken. They still wanted to seize him. They still wanted to keep him kill him more than ever now. They'd been pricked to the heart with conviction, but it only made them angry. It made them indignant. It made them cut to the heart with rage rather than sorrowful grief. But for fear of the people, they knew they didn't dare lay hands on him, because they knew that all the people believed that he was a true prophet sent from God, and they didn't dare touch him. So the fear of the people kept them from doing any harm to him. So during all of these teachings in the temple, during this Passover week, this last week, before he was crucified, under the most terrible threats and rebukes, the priests and the elders were kept restrained. They were kept spellbound. They were kept unable to lift a hand against Jesus until his work was done. So, church today, let's pray. Let's pray for God to give us penitential sorrows. Let's pray that we seek him every day, pour out his Holy Spirit. He promised to do that in the last days. And oh, how we need him. Oh, how we need his help today. Lord, I got up this morning and said, Jesus, I need you to help me more today than I've ever needed you in any day in my life. And I meant it. Let's pray that we follow hard after the leading of the Holy Spirit as he pours out his Holy Spirit upon us. That we not lean unto our own understanding. Let's not try to even imitate those who are around us today pushed God aside and who said, we can take care of this. We are our own masters. We have a right to do whatever we want to do. And oh, we love you, God, but we're going to take over now. Let's pray that we don't fall heir to that, church, because we can. Don't think that we're so holy and just that we can't be deceived. We've got to keep our eyes and our minds upon the Lord Jesus. Pray. Pray that we have the grace, the ability to stand still. And if we have to be martyrs, and we might have to be martyrs one day, that we have the strength to do that by God's grace. Because he is coming back again. Householder's coming back. He's coming back to his vineyard. He's going to gather his church. Going to gather the husbandmen that were true and that kept the vineyard, and it's now ready for harvest. I believe America's ready for that harvest today. I believe the world is ready for that harvest today. So let's keep on working, keep tending to it until Jesus comes, so that when he comes, we can present ourselves as that good fruit, that church without spot or blemish. We're in that vineyard today. Let's be our prayer today. So, are there any comments about this parable? It's mind-boggling, isn't it? Scripture is so rapidly being fulfilled. And this parable is just laying it out to us as he laid it right out to the priests and the rulers of Israel. He's just laid it out to us today. It's so plain. I don't know why people say, I don't understand the Bible. I don't understand the end days. I don't understand. It's so plain. Father, we thank you for your word and help us, Jesus. That's our prayer, that we might be the best